Climate change is definitely a hot topic, and former American Vice President Al Gore has made two documentaries on this very controversial subject, winning an Oscar for An Inconvenient Truth and this year releasing an inconvenient sequel, Truth to Power. Here's some of the strong difference of opinion in this latest documentary between Donald Trump and Al Gore.
It's freezing here. Speaking of global warming, where is we need some global warming? It's freezing.
The most criticized scene in the movie An Inconvenient Truth was showing that the combination of sea level rise and storm surge would flood the 9/11 memorial site. And people said, what a terrible exaggeration.
Hurricane Sandy slammed into New York City last night, flooding the World Trade Center site.
Storms get stronger and more destructive. Watch the water splash off the city. This is global warming.
Well, Australian climate scientist Professor Tim Flannery supports Al Gore's push for action, and he joins us now from Melbourne. Tim, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We have some viewer questions for you later, but firstly, can there ever be solid agreement, do you believe, that climate change is really happening?
Well, you know, there's still a few people who are holding out, saying, no, it isn't happening, but increasingly people are recognising it because they're feeling it in their own lives. So we'll never have full agreement, but we've got enough agreement to move forward. And you see that with Australia. You know, we've had 100% renewable energy deployment now for over a decade. So the world is moving on the issue.
And Tim, is one of the problems that there's so much fragmentation, I suppose, in the argument. Firstly, you've got people who say that climate change isn't happening at all. In fact, the temperatures aren't moving or haven't moved recently. Then you've got people saying that climate change is happening, but it's not because of man-made factors. Then you have people who are saying, well, look, climate change is happening and it might be happening by man-made factors, but really Australia is such a tiny percentage that there's nothing we can do about it. Then it's like people who say, well, climate change is happening, but how should we actually respond? Should we have binding or non-binding targets? I mean, is there really actually that much we can do, and can we agree on what to do?
Yeah, well, that's a fair point. You know, there's a lot of disagreement about the issue, and there's lots of stages of denial. But, you know, the facts on the ground are that we're now producing very cheap energy from clean energy sources, which is an important part of the response. So South Australia over the last few months has had the cheapest energy price in Australia. Because of all of the wind and solar it's got, you don't need to pay for fuel costs for that electricity. And the system is working well now. So you know, there's various states of denial, but the facts on the ground are telling a different story.
There are many who disagree with you, and I'm sure you're familiar with them, Tim. But if you're right and we keep going the way we are, how much time do we have on this planet before things go seriously wrong, if they're not already?
Well, it's taken 200 years to build up this level of greenhouse gases we've got. And this last year we saw the largest increase ever in atmospheric CO2 levels. Having said that, you know, we're starting to just flatten off on our use of fossil fuels, so we think that'll decline over the next few years. You know, what that adds up to really is probably through the 20s and the 2030s, we'll start to see increasing problems. But we really hope that after that, and particularly closer to 2050, we'll start to see that we come to grips with the problem and we start seeing a lesser threat. It's a bit like the ozone hole, you know. We started way back in 1989 to try to fix the ozone hole. It's only in the last few years that it started to really shrink seriously after decades of effort. So it's a similar sort of problem.
Right. And Tim, can you just take us through, I mean, the climate skeptics on the right will say that, you know, over the last decade and a half, for example, that temperatures have plateaued, that, you know, your own predictions and other predictions that we'd be in endless drought, the dams would dry up, didn't happen because eventually it did rain. We had an incredibly dry, I think, sort of September, October here, and then suddenly the rains did come. Can you just take us through the actual proof, the evidence that climate change is still happening and it is going to have a catastrophic effect?
Sure, yeah. Well, look, if you look at, you know, the average temperature increases, which we can measure very accurately now using satellite and so forth, we see that, you know, year on year, decade on decade, there's a slow increase. There's sometimes when it flattens off a bit, but over the longer term, those temperatures continue to rise. This last year was the second warmest year on record. And you look at what's happening around the world at different places and you see big impacts. So in Australia, the Great Barrier Reef is really one of the places where we're seeing the most severe impacts. These enormous underwater heat waves that come in and bring hot water and sit against the reef and kill the coral. So, you know, last year we had, for the second year running, big bleaching events. And now between 70 and 80% of the coral on the reef is dead as a result of that warming. So that is a real fact on the ground. Anyone can go up and see it themselves, see the impacts and understand that's the result of warmer waters, which come from the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere trapping heat, transferring it into the oceans.
Tim, you mentioned earlier clean energy sources and how we need to be going for those. What would you say, though, to many people who can't afford to put solar panels on their houses? It's too expensive.
Well, look, if you're in that sort of position, you've obviously got to buy from the grid. So what we hope is that we will move to those cheaper sources so your power bill in the future will be lower. You know, at the moment, we're in a situation where some of our old coal-fired power plants, like Liddell in New South Wales, you know, that'll cost about $1 billion in maintenance costs just to keep open for an extra 5 years. Whereas in South Australia, where we've got lots of wind and solar and you're not paying for fuel costs for those, we're getting the cheaper power prices now in the country. So that's the future, to a more balanced grid with lots of clean, cheap electricity. And that's where we need to move to as quickly as we can.
Tim, as I mentioned earlier, we've got some lovely viewer questions and comments on our Facebook page. Can I start by asking you your response to this viewer question from Darnell, who says, convince me that climate change isn't a natural phenomenon, that we really don't have much control over, no matter what we do. So far, no one has been able to. What's your response to that?
Well, I'd say, you know, what the scientists do and what you need to look at are the various sources that cause our climate to vary. We can examine all of those and see what they're doing to the planet. And they just don't add up to the impacts that we're seeing today. In order to understand what's happening to our climate now, you've got to factor in all of those greenhouse gases that humans are putting into the atmosphere that are causing these changes. So it is a complex system, but if you're a farmer or anyone on the ground, you can see the results. You know they're different to what's happened before. And the only scientific explanation for that is the additional greenhouse gases.
And Tim, the next viewer this morning, Mary, asks, how do you maintain your sanity and, more importantly, your sense of humour when those in government deny there is a problem?
Well, I've got pretty deep faith in people, to be honest with you. I think that average people have got a great deal of common sense. We can see that we're moving towards solutions, and that's what people really want, particularly young people. And that's what keeps me going. I talk to students a lot, university students, those who really can see, yes, we can do something about this. I can make a great career for myself by trying to introduce cleaner energy and trying to develop technologies that get some of the CO2 out of the air. It's really energising stuff. Dealing with Parliament House in Canberra is a different matter. And honestly, I agree with you. It's really tough.
And Tim, one more viewer now, Glenn, who says to you, stop spreading fear and lies. The world is just fine. Here is a question. This is what Glenn asks. How come the dams are full when you said they'd be dry by now and we're still paying for that useless desalination plant? You should be more worried about trigger-hungry despots than fictitious climate rubbish.
Well, I just say, Glenn, that, you know, there's facts on the ground we can't deny, and one of them is that in Perth, where I was warning about really serious water deficits, they built some desal plants back in 2001, 2002, and now that city gets more than half of its water from desal because the rainfall is just really diminishing in that part of the world. Adelaide's another area that needs it. The East Coast rainfall is very variable. It's a bit of a different story there. But, you know, we do have a water problem. We've got these very big cities now. We've got to maintain adequate water supplies for them. And desal probably is going to be part of that for Australia into the future.
And, Tim, often I find the elephant in the room in this debate is one power source, which is completely carbon neutral and can provide very efficient and cheap baseload power, and that's nuclear. Is that something that you think should be in the mix?
Well, look, I've got no objections, really. Every power source has its own problems and liabilities. And nuclear, you add that in, yes, we know all about its problems, but it's got some benefits as well. The real problem for nuclear is it's so expensive to build a new plant. You've got a, you know, $15 or $20 billion investment that pays back over 70 years. And people look at that and say, well, why should I do that when I can put in some solar panels or some wind turbines that cost a few thousand or $1 million and get a much quicker payback. And that's why all of the capital in the world is rushing to the renewables rather than to nuclear. You know, no one's proposing to build nuclear power plants in places like Australia, and where they are being built, it's government money that's funding them.
Professor Tim Flannery, thank you so much for your time this morning. It's much appreciated.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Al Gore's new documentary and inconvenient sequel, Truth to Power, is out now on DVD and Blu-ray. And for our studio audience, you are all going home with a copy today. Yeah.